Here we go. I have been watching with as much interest as any of you to see if the forecast that I laid out in previous videos has turned out to be accurate. And I tell you, if it was not accurate, I would not be posting videos now. I would say, forget it, it was wrong, and go in some other direction. But in looking back, I said that on or about July 20th, and especially in the latter part of July, the last week of July, stretching into August, you will see the writing on the wall of instability, structural, global instability in the financial system would become so apparent. The polarization in politics around the planet is such that there's a stalemate, and the instability of stalling out is becoming very present. We realize that we're stalling out, and when that occurs, the writing is on the wall for the eventual collapse. And looking back, I would say that it's been right on the money. I also said in the video on August 8th, the stock market will not crash on that day. There's going to be volatility, but it will not crash. And I said that what's going to happen is the banks and the governments are going to do everything they can to try and stabilize the situation. And now we find out that last week, during that tremendous volatile period when S&P gave the downgrade and the whipsawing of the market was going back and forth, and we said, oh my gosh, is a crash coming? I said, no, this is going to happen, but it's not the crash, it's going to be propped up. We find out now the European Central Bank, the ECB, bought $32 billion worth of mostly Spanish bonds to prevent the rate on bonds to go over 6%. I think it was at 5 and was heading towards 6. And when you get over 6, it's like a death spiral begins in the country. I think Greece now is what is it, 28% or some ridiculous number that you cannot pull out of that. You know, and they say that 6% goes over 6, the long-term prospect is so bad that it then will start spiraling and escalating higher and higher. So the European Central Bank bought $32 billion worth of Spanish bonds to prevent that from happening. Now we know the European Central Bank is like the Federal Reserve in that it can print money. Okay, and we know the Federal Reserve bailed out the U.S. economy, stabilized it by what? Printing money, right? Quantitative easing. Now we know that these are temporary measures and that the rotten foundation is still present. You cannot simply print money, print your way out of this situation. Temporarily, it can prevent disastrous situations from occurring, but down the road you know that there are consequences to be paid. It's not real money, it's fiat money. It doesn't really stand for anything. And then today we have Morgan Stanley coming out with their forecast for a probable double dip recession. Okay, and the markets have reacted very negatively to that. So we are seeing more and more and more indications. I believe right now almost everybody in their mind realizes we're heading for another recession. It would not surprise anyone, I believe, at this point, except for maybe some entrepreneurs who are perennially optimistic, Pollyannas, who believe they can make a ton of money no matter what happens. So for them, say, hey, what recession? I can make money. Everything is great with me. But the vast majority of people are not these super operators who are capable of having this entrepreneurial knack. Very few people are like that. Most of us get caught up in the wake of history, the wake of these events. And so they have real effects on our lives. And we can say that a double dip recession is a bad thing. However, saying that it's a double dip recession at this point is actually being very Pollyannish. and very optimistic. When these big investment banks say this, they're trying to soften the blow. They themselves don't want to face the music. You know, they're still looking at things like, what's the best scenario? And what they're really saying is, the best scenario we see right now is a double dip recession. That's the best we see. And you can bet that there are those who are analyzing the situation quantitatively, looking at it, the figures. I do it intuitively, different. But there are geniuses in quantitative analysis who right now are looking at things and saying, you know what? We're not going to make it. We're coming to the end of the road here. The way things are structured, it's just not going to go forward. It is going to stall out. Economies, the way we've structured things, they cannot stall out. They have to grow. We can't have zero growth in the way we structure things. It doesn't work. So the thing to be most concerned about is a stall out, a stagnation. That's a death blow to the way we've structured this economy right now. The world financial structure cannot withstand a global stall out. And everything seems to be pointed exactly in that direction. And the warnings are coming up from major institutions, not just the intuitives like myself. Major institutions are saying these things. And you know when they say that, that's a best case scenario. They're still trying to put a silver lining on things. They don't want to breed a pessimism. Nobody other than perhaps some deep inside speculators who want to short things. Nobody else wants to really breed pessimism, because pessimism will stall the markets out. The whole machinery will stall out. Like there's no oil in it. It'll overheat. It'll burn. So these big banks, etc., they want to keep confidence going. So when they say they see a bad recession coming, double dip, that's a rosy picture, silver lining for them. I'm sure they're thinking, you know, it's probably going to be worse than this, but they're hoping that they can keep people having some confidence. Consumer confidence is very important. However, the talk about us once again trying to jack up our credit cards, put everything on our credit cards, and to prime the pumps, for instance, which many of us did back in 2005, 6, 7, 8, and before the recession hit, we were really told to consume, consume, consume to keep the economy going, put it on our credit cards, and that by doing this that we would avoid the recession and be able to pay things off. The economy would be robust and we'd be able to pay our debts off. What happened was we did not avoid it, and now all of us, so many of us, are saddled with a tremendous credit card debt when all we were trying to do is be good citizens, good economic citizens, and try to follow the advice that we were given, which was disastrous advice. Now the same advice is being given out. Put stuff on credit cards right now. Well, at this point, it may not even matter, because when the collapse comes, nobody's going to be able to pay anything off. So that's another way to look at it. However, I don't advise doing that. Too much stress involved. Now, as this train wreck, or as someone said, this financial tsunami in slow motion is occurring, and we're watching it, at what point do we realize it really is a tsunami and not a recession? I know as things begin to continue to unfold through latter part of August now and into September, people will be saying, you'll hear it all the time, we're going into another recession. Looks like a bad recession. We're now in a recession that will come out. Yes, we're in a recession, recession, recession. But if you keep noticing, you'll realize we're headed towards a collapse. We're not going to pull out of this recession. This is curtains for that's the way we have things structured. It's going to require an entire restructuring. Now, the fact is, if you pulled everyone on this planet, and honestly, you could get an honest answer, you would find out that a great many people actually are rooting for the collapse so that it can be restructured. There's a lot of those people who see they wanted it to die, the system. They say the system is corrupt, it's terrible, etc. And they make a strong case for that. They want it to collapse. Okay. And there are others who realize that this collapse is going to be more severe than we expect. The idea that we can somehow make a smooth transition into a new structure, a better structure, is highly idealistic and not really practical. And who's to say that this new structure won't be even worse than the one before it? Won't be based on a tremendous amount of personal control over your life by a central world bank, a central world currency, identity, some type of electronic identity for everybody. All those factors will be in play, and people will say, we have to do this to avoid that terrible collapse that took place. Now, who is to say that those who want the system to collapse and want to institute this new structure, who's to say that they might not intentionally collapse it? Okay? Who's to say that there's not somebody with their finger on a button somewhere? Just like we went through the atomic age and we know there was someone who had their finger on the button somewhere in some bunker, you know, in a silo. There was someone who had a finger on the button. They could launch a nuclear attack. There were several people involved, but it could happen. There may be several people with their finger on the financial button somewhere, but they are abetted and enabled by a general feeling around them in the atmosphere and the people and the culture that they move in, that collapsing the system is actually the right thing to do, the better thing to do, because there's a new system that they want to put in place. So it could very well be there's someone with their finger on the button. And the system has been booby-trapped, has been rigged to be pulled down at a certain point. And when the instability becomes bad enough, when this recession becomes severe and starts going into a severe depression, it's easy enough for them to push that button and collapse the whole thing and then claim, it disproves what a terrible system it was, because look at this complete collapse. But I don't think that's an honest conclusion necessarily. The system has a lot of flaws, but I don't believe that inherently it would on its own accord completely collapse. I believe it through help and being booby-trapped and rigged in a certain way, it can be collapsed. But that gives an excuse, a pretext then, for bringing in a new, completely new system, worldwide global control over all finances, and ultimately over your life and over your freedom completely, okay? Where you can be denied purchases in many, many different ways. I went in to get some gasoline yesterday, and I filled up the vehicle, and then I needed to put some in a gas can. So I did a separate purchase for that. Big mistake. Card declined. Can't do it, you see. And I said, went in and paid cash for it. Okay. But what if you don't have cash? You see how easy it is to have something decline just because, well, your movements are suspect. We don't like the fact that you purchased something here and then you traveled somewhere and purchased it there. You know, we want your travel to be restricted. For instance, your travel movements could be restricted based on disallowing your capability to purchase anything, right? So if you're put on a restricted list as far as your movements go, you can purchase things within your town, but you cannot travel to some other place that you're restricted from, and you can't make any purchases there. So you can see that there could be an unbelievable amount of control put over your life, and you would essentially lose personal freedom in the name of bringing about a more equitable, stable financial system in the world based on blaming the previous system as being completely terrible and unstable because, look, it completely collapsed. What a devastating thing that is. However, it could have been actually demolished. Okay? It could have been an inside job. The collapse of the financial system could very well be an inside job. I'm saying it is an inside job. The actual collapse. The recession is being brought about by part of this inside job. It's also being brought about by instability within the system. It's true that there are a lot of problems. It's been gained too much speculation in all this. But the system really could be cleaned up from that, all that speculation, and made to work a lot better. Okay, and we could still retain some degree of freedom here in this world, but we are headed directly towards a severe, catastrophic loss of freedom in this world. There's no question about that. And I've been asked, this situation, we know it's really going to be a very unpleasant situation coming up. Are there any other options? Can you bug out of this place, out of this planet, somehow go to another dimension, etc., like that? And really, I would say the answer to that is yes. It could very well be possible. And that's something to at least put your antenna up about and be aware of. Okay, I don't believe that we will be left entirely without options, and we merely have to either engage in some resistance or succumb to the new structure that is going to be forced on everyone as a genius remedy. It's like someone will come along and say, I have this perfect solution to your economic devastation, and here is the plan, and the world will be brought back from this terrible, abyss that we're in, and chaos, and suddenly everything will seem to function again because we have all this sophisticated technology enables everything to flow once again. The stagnation will disappear, but also along with that stagnation disappearing is your freedom will be gone as well. Something to consider. So I would say my antenna is definitely up as far as options go. And again, someone mentioned, is it possible to do a dimensional shift or something like that? And I'm saying yes, I believe it. It's something like that is certainly feasible in some way. There are surprises ahead of us, so stay tuned. Okay, that's very good. That's it.